I had told him about a dream I'd had, and it was him having a fall. It wasn't nice. He turned around to me and he said, "It'll never happen to me. I have two children to come home to."
The death of 25-year-old Adrian Ledger after a fall in Corowa on Sunday has rocked the racing industry all the way to the top.
Even to remember that silly little letter that he wrote about, you know, if I ever die, you know, look after these people, please. And
racing is more than a job, it's a lifestyle, a passion that's a bloodline for life. But unfortunately, there are those who have paid the ultimate price, just trying to make a living, chasing their dreams. Mark Goring and Adrian Ledger were two young men, jockeys, cut down before their prime by the twist of fate that racing only knows too well. As we remember the more than 500 riders, young men, jockeys, who have lost their lives, this is the story of Mark and Adrian, told through the eyes of those who knew them best, loved them most, and can never forget.
Mark and Emma Goring married in March 2002. Their two-year-old daughter Madeline was a flower girl, and they were looking forward to adding to a family they thought they could never have.
I was told I was infertile, so we actually went to the doctors regarding something completely different. Mark said, "While we're here, can you please give her a pregnancy test? She's been extremely moody." I was looking at him as if to say, "I can't have any children," and it was positive. Very excited, extremely scared. Both of us were, because we were quite young. Mark was 20 and I was 23. And Mark was still an apprentice at this stage. He came out of his time just before Madeline was born. And when Madeline was born, she was just daddy's little girl. I didn't really get a look in.
But it's great responsibility. Mark's the doting dad. Yes. That must have been a tough time.
Very tough. He was a changed person, and when Madeline came along, he was a changed person. He knew then it was time to heads down, and I'm the provider of this family. He loved it when I took Madeline to the races. It wasn't always possible at that age. He'd take her into the mounting yard if he had won the race, and he held her up at Mornington one day and after winning a race and said, "This is my trophy." He was just so proud of her. Not always the rides were there. If he was injured or suspended, whatever, it was very hard. The not knowing of how much we were having to live by each week was probably the hardest thing, but he always made sure that he covered all the bills and the house, everything.
One of Mark's great friends and rivals in racing was Adrian Ledger. He too had met the love of his life as a teenager.
We met when we were both very young. I would have been 15 and Aid would have been 16. And I was helping a friend out by doing some waitressing at a Hunter Club ball. And Aid was there with a group of mates, and he wasn't actually involved in the hunting side of things. He was actually just beginning, or probably just started his apprenticeship. So he was there with some friends, and his friends come and asked me if I would dance with him.
He didn't do it himself?
No. Oh. He was pretty shy, and he probably looked about 12 years old because he was so baby-faced. And then the next following year, he was there again.
Took a year?
And, yeah, took a year. Well, we're another year older and wiser, and we had another dance, and then he ended up calling me after that, not long after that, and we had a date. Went to the movies and he brought his friend.
So
we were full of confidence.
He had a friend ask you to dance and he had a friend come to your first date.
Yep.
Who would have thought what would have happened? Because I think he was one of the first jockeys with a big mobile phone. He would have called you on a...
He did. He was actually in South Australia, I think, at the time. He was having a stint, and I'm not actually 100% sure which stable he was with, but he wasn't at home in Yarrawonga at that stage. He was having a bit of a time. I was still in school at that stage. I was in year 10, and everyone was discovering partying and social life, and I was still very much committed to my horses and that passion. And when I met Adrian, it just all seemed to make sense.
He left school very young to pursue that apprenticeship that he wanted?
Yeah, he left. He always used to joke and say that, you know, he left in grade 9, I think it was, or year 9. And but he certainly had some great skills still. You know, he was very clever, really.
How did it come about to be a bit more serious from you at school and him becoming an apprentice?
I think I could possibly be to blame for him not really going on with his riding all that much, but he ended up moving back to Melbourne to do his apprenticeship in Melbourne for a while, and then moving home eventually back to his family in Yarrawonga at that stage. And I finished school. We did spend 1 year in Melbourne together when I was at university, and he was riding down in Melbourne, and we were living together for the year.
How tough was it for a young jockey though? I mean, it's not an easy task being an apprentice, is it?
Yeah, it was really tough on him. He really enjoyed it, but with his height and his weight, it was really tough. Yeah.
Obviously you became much more than just living together and good friends.
Yeah, that's right. He was such a grounded person, and he seemed to really know exactly what he wanted, and we both knew what we wanted and settled quite quickly, and we talked about having a family and getting married, you know, when we were still very young. We would have been 21, 22 when we talked of those things, and then we got married. He would have been 24 and I was 23 at that age.
Did you enjoy watching him riding and getting this career going?
Yeah, I did. I loved watching him. I loved going to the races, and I used to help out and strap a few. Wasn't brave enough to ride track work. But, yeah, I used to follow him a bit to the races when I could, and work in the stables, like I said, in the mornings.
Did you ever have any fears about what he was doing?
No. I think it was just the industry, and with his accident, it was just so unfortunate with what happened. But yeah, no, he loved his riding. He certainly had other interests, like he just seemed to be very, he wasn't entirely focused on the racing. Like we talked about possibly going into a saddlery or something. He had a little bit of gear on the outside, like he'd developed the safety stirrup iron, and possibly after he may have finished riding with his height and things like that. It's hard to know, but I'd like to think we probably would have, he would have stayed in the family business, and maybe we would have opened a saddlery or something. And he had another little sidekick. He'd just started off with some palm trees. He bought a lot of palm seeds on the internet, and he'd started planting all these palm seeds and incubating them and things. So it wasn't all horses. There was lots of fun and lots of social. Yeah, he was a great family person. He was really committed to his family and his grandparents and things, and a really warm and loving family person. We never discussed the seriousness of his job or of the danger involved. That's for
sure. You found out you were pregnant?
Yeah. I was so sick for the first 3 months with really bad morning sickness, and probably about a month before Adrian's accident, I was feeling much better and feeling really good, and remember thinking, you know, it just couldn't get any better. Life was so good, and we were in such a good place.
Coming up, racing careers cut tragically short, culminating in days indelibly etched in the lives of the Goring and Ledger families.
The hair stood up on the back of my neck, and I just knew that it wasn't right.
If you could ever live 48 hours of hell, that was the start of it.
Mark Goring and Adrian Ledger were two young jockeys with everything to live for, expected fathers whose racing careers were beginning to take off, until fate dealt them the cruelest possible hand.
A couple of months before he passed away, he won the Newmarket in Tasmania.
Viscount Alexander holding on from Red Dragon, and Viscount Alexander wins the Newmarket.
He was flying after that. He was going so well, and we thought he'd finally got a break. And he was getting the rides, and he was getting the better horses, and we got robbed. He left that morning and spoke to me on the way to the races, and I had told him about a dream I'd had, and it was him having a fall. It wasn't nice. He turned around to me and he said, "It'll never happen to me. I have two children to come home to. It'll never happen." And then it did.
We were actually watching the race and I said, "Oh, it's going all right, this thing." I said, "But it needs a run." And they were racing very tight. And next minute, Mark had gone down and the hair stood up on the back of my neck. And I just knew that it wasn't right, that it wasn't going to be a good outcome, because I'd seen him fall before and I'd never had that feeling.
I heard the fall and I was at a girlfriend's house and I had a phone call from the stewards letting me know that he was being airlifted to the Alfred Hospital. They told me he was unconscious at the time. He was on life support. I got to my brothers took me to the hospital. He landed probably 5 minutes later. I just felt numb. I knew it wasn't good. And then when the neurosurgeon came in and said, "We're not winning here," I couldn't get a grip of that. He had a 2.5-year-old to come home to, an unborn child. He was at the prime of his life.
I went in to see him and it was just like he was asleep. He was just, you know, they hadn't done anything with him at that stage, but he just looked like he was asleep. He didn't look like he'd been in a bad fall because he had no visible injuries or anything. And I remember the surgeons telling me that he may die. And it was like he wasn't talking to me. It was like I was watching a television show or something. This can't be happening to Mark. It can't be happening to me. You know, I can't lose a child.
Yeah, I had to pinch myself. Is this really happening? It was like a nightmare. It was like the nightmare I'd had the night before.
It took me ages to even realise that he wasn't there anymore. You know, after the doctor came in and told us that he wasn't doing very well, and I said, "Well, when do you make the decision that, you know, to turn off the life support?" And he said, "You don't need to do that. He's making that for himself." So we didn't have to make that decision to turn it off. He wouldn't put us through that.
I found it very hard saying goodbye. As I went into the room, I could still see his chest moving. Obviously, it was the life support. That's very hard to get a grip of. Seeing that, knowing I would do anything, you know, if I had to care for him for the rest of my life, for the rest of his life, I would have. I wanted to. I wasn't given that choice.
Shock. Very surreal. You can't believe it. It's just, you're in a daze. You just can't believe that it's happened to you and to him, his family, his little daughter and his son on the way. And I don't know, it's just, even now I think someday I'm going to wake up and this has all been a bad dream. You know, it's just unreal to think that he's not around anymore.
I knew when I saw Madeline, I couldn't say everything's going to be okay. I had to be completely honest with her. She knew how bad the fall was, even though she was 2.5. She stayed at my friend's that night. They looked after her. She hadn't seen me for probably 48 hours. And when she did see me, she saw a mess. And I was completely honest with her. Very hard for a 2.5-year-old to get a grip on, but why couldn't they fix him? That's what doctors do. That was heartbreaking, telling her that.
Mark didn't know he was having a son. He said it was like opening Christmas presents in November. He didn't want to know until it was actually, you know, he arrived. And it was like we were at the hospital while Emma was in labour, and I'm just waiting and waiting and waiting to see what the outcome was going to be. And when it was a boy, it was like, hooray, you know. Everyone was so happy that he had a little boy. Just all he wanted was the pigeon pair. He had both, and he would have been crying, I think.
I couldn't believe that this child I have just had, his son, is healthy. His dad went to work and never came home. He went to work a healthy man and never came home. I found that very hard to comprehend, that this child that has just been born is healthy and his dad made him.
I said he's been cloned, you know. If there's such a thing as reincarnation, Mark's come back as Mitchell. Unbelievable. Sometimes I'll be here and I'll see Mitchell doing something, and it's like, what's your Mark? The little mannerisms he does, the funny little things he does, or, you know, a little dance. Just, Mark could never keep still, you know, and Mitchell's the same.
That must give you so much mixed emotion.
It does. It gives me a lot of pleasure. And at the same time, it does, you know, cause a little bit of pain to think that I haven't got him anymore.
I have kept a virtually a lifelong history here of Mark as a rider and son, even going back, gee, that's a long time ago, this one, isn't it?
It is, yeah. That was his first pony.
Little grey pony.
Yeah, I'll never forget when he first, when he got him going, he actually took off down the driveway and forgot that there was trees down the driveway, and the branches have knocked him off. he just got back on and, you know, kept going. He just loved it. He was just a natural at it.
And obviously loved being around the horses.
Yeah. From an early age, all he wanted to do was be a rider. And I said, you know, he used to say to him, it's a hard, mate, you know, you can't eat. I'll be right. He said, I'm going to be a top jockey and I'm going to win plenty of races and I'm going to buy you a house. So.
Well, you won plenty of races. You look through here and you've kept everything, but as anyone does, you remember the first one.
I do, yes. The first one was good. His first actual winner. I was actually at the races that day and I had a horse for Eric Musgrave that I'd taken up there and saddled up and strapped it. And Mark won the race and I was too busy cheering him. I didn't even see where Eric's horse had run.
So that was at Kyneton.
Yes, yeah, that was
Cautious good. Cavalier.
Yes.
The first winner.
Yep, Cautious Cavalier.
You wrote a piece for a magazine, From Mum to Son. What inspired that?
I was actually reading, it was That's Life, actually, and I was reading a story there one day about a little girl who'd passed away, and I thought, I can do this. It was like, it was my feelings, my life with Mark and how he wanted to be a jockey and, you know, just how it affected us and the way the racing industry was. Like, there's a lot of trainers out there and jockeys out there that trainers are trying to take other trainers' horses and jockeys are trying to get rides, the better rides. And when it comes to the pinch, though, they become one big family. Mm. You know, they're all there for you. It was like he had a feeling that he wasn't going to be around for a long time. Like, even from the time he was a little boy, he was always in a hurry to do things. Like, he'd never walk anywhere. He would always run. And I'd say, slow down, mate. And even when he got with Emma, as she says, I was at Oakbank with horses, and when I come back, she'd moved in. And then they told me that, you know, she was pregnant. I went, oh, Mark, you know, you're only a baby yourself. Like, how are you going to be as a father? But he was just amazing. He just doted on his little girl. As you can see here, he's just, you know, he'd spend as much time with her as he could. I'd be waiting at the track for him to come and ride work. And he wouldn't want to get out of bed because she was there and Emma was there. So, yeah. But then, you know, when Mitchell was coming along, he really knuckled down and got into it. He was just turned his life around. He was, you know, had two to care for then, and, you know, that was what he wanted to do.
It was a very coincidental thing. Their birthdays are within days of one another. They both little snowy-haired boys. They ended up at Flemington together in the same stable, both getting married very similar times, both having babies on the way when the accidents happened. And yeah, just there's very been a lot of similarities in their life, the parallel things that happen.
I can remember quite clearly the day. It was the Sunday of the long weekend, and I was working retail at that stage, so I worked half the morning at Justine's, and they were over at the Corowa races in New South Wales. And myself and one of the older gentlemen that used to come and help, we went inside to John and Kerry's house and watched the race. So we watched it on the TV and seen the fall, and yeah, it didn't really click of how the seriousness it could have been. Like, certainly didn't expect, you know, what was about to unfold to happen.
I heard the announcer call that there'd been a fall, and of course my name came out, and I ran down the track, and I could see that. We'd always said just move, just lift a finger, lift your arm, do anything, but there was no movement.
I knew Kerry was at the race course, so I rang her straight away, and she had panic in her voice, and she said he's unconscious, but he's breathing on his own at this stage. And they're taking him into the Corowa Hospital, so just come straight over.
If you could ever live 48 hours of hell, that was the start of it, you know. We got back here, Ked was still at Corowa Hospital. They were having trouble finding a neurosurgical ward. In the end, they flew him to Canberra by helicopter later in the day. The guy that we were told when we got to Corowa that he was probably okay. When the specialist come down on the chopper, just walked out and just basically said it was all over.
Everyone seemed to be spread out that day, and Brad was in Singapore holidaying, his first holiday overseas, and so we had to contact him but not panic him and get him home.
They took me in on my own into the room where they had Adrian connected to monitors and things, and as soon as I seen him I just lost it. Like, I'm a pretty strong person, and it was a really hard image to see.
Do you know that was the worst at that stage? Is that when you really knew for the first time?
I think I still didn't really know then at that stage just how bad it was going to be. Like, yeah, certainly he'd obviously died from head injuries, but there was no open injuries, but his face was very swollen, and he looked very different with the swelling, I guess. He was on the bed, they'd stripped all of his clothes off and just had lots of monitors on him.
Yeah, thinking also at the time that you're pregnant with
his child. Exactly. I think people say, how did you ever do that? And I don't think you even think it at the time. You just do what you can and you cope as best as you can to get through what was a fairly terrible time.
His heart went to somebody, and his liver saved a couple of young kids, and I think there was about six people that he directly saved their lives, and that's magnificent. I'm proud of him for that. I'm proud of him for a lot of things. I'm very proud of him for that.
It is unbelievable to think that someone of his age would have things in place the way he did. Like, I'm very fortunate that he was, you know, he did the things he did and had things in place to look after his family should something happen. And even to remember about the silly little letter that he wrote about, you know, if I ever die, you know, look after these people, please. And
Aid had written, should he die, what he wanted to tell us, tell his family and tell his friends what they meant to him, and also that what should take place at his funeral. And he was very, very clear in Aid's plain language that it should be a celebration of his life, with a few drinks had by all, and that we were to celebrate the life and not be too sad and tied up with the loss. Well, of course we were, but we were able to fulfil what he had wanted, which was an amazing thing to be able to do, and we're very thankful that we were able to find the letter and do that.
And it was also for Amy? You were...
Yeah, we were able to pass the letter on to Amy and to friends, and it outlined, you know, that they'd hoped they had had children, and sure enough, Amy was pregnant at the time. So that was another wish that he had hoped for in his life that was granted. Unfortunately, he never got to see it, but she was pregnant nevertheless, so that was an amazing part of it as well.
I remember him saying one day to a kid that he was teaching years later, he said, look, it doesn't matter how good you can ride or what sort of horseman you think you are, he said, when you get out in a race and you hear the feet hitting each other, he said, it's really frightening, it's dangerous, and be careful. And I distinctly remember Adrian saying those words to some apprentices. And he respected it. He was a very careful young guy and would never take a risk. And I always used to say to him, Aid, you know, you're riding up here at the non-tabs and the small meetings while you learn your craft. Don't try and be a hero. Don't take a gap and not there. And look after yourself. There's always another day. And he rode that way. So what happened in the end was fate. It wasn't as though he was a go-get-em, carefree sort of jock. He cared about his other riders and he cared about the horses he rode. And it's not easy, Bruce. And some guys it falls into place for, and whatever they help on, they win. And other guys, and lots of them, have to work really, really hard just to survive. And those guys are the ones that make up the industry. He was just born with horses' blood running through his veins, you know, like I'd never seen a kid so into horses. From the minute he could get out of the house, he was still in nappies, he would put on a tantrum if I was heading off show jumping for a weekend if he couldn't come. I had to get my dad to come to all the shows with me to mind Aid when I was riding, and you know, he had his first pony. Snoopy was on the truck when Aid was three or four, and he became well known around all the show circuits all over Victoria and New South Wales, young Adrian, and he was just a horseman from day one, and then when Chris and Brad came along they were the same, so I had a lot of fun. My best friends were my four boys, and we had this passion for just wanting to be around horses, and in those early days it was a little bit of barracking for Uncle George's racehorses and a lot of show life, which was just wonderful. I remember really distinctly one night, Aid became very, very close, of course, with his years with his grandfather around all the shows, and my father was a really keen horseman, and Aid came back from having dinner with him one night, and he was about 11 or 12, and he was a little snowy-headed kid with buck teeth, and he walked in and he said, Pa and I got something to tell you, Dad. And I said, what's that, Aid? He said, I'm going to be a jockey. And I said, what? What are you talking about? He said, we're all too big and heavy to be jockeys. He said, no, Pa calls me Half Point and I'm going to be a jockey. And the seed was sown on that night, and that's the way it ended up. Years later, Dad drove him everywhere and they become inseparable friends. When he got into the jockey mode, it was tough. He couldn't ride much better than 54 and a half on average, and he was getting tall quickly. He was small early, but then he shot up. And life was hard for him because he couldn't get, the phone would ring, but he couldn't make the rides with the claim. And it's changed a lot today. Weights have gone up and made it a lot easier for the kids. But Mark was different. He was a great mate of Aid's, and he rode all my lightweights. Aid would say, well, Dad, I can't ride 54 or 53 and a half, but Mark can he have the ride? And so I used both these boys a lot for different jobs. And the two of them clashed throughout that next season in the Northeast Apprentices Premiership. And it went down to the wire, the last race and the last day of the meeting. Aid beat Mark by one win, and I think it might have been at Benalla. They had a lot of fun and they laughed and joked about it, and there was never any animosity. They were just good buddies. And when Mark rode up in the northeast, he would stay in a little love shack that's just behind the house here that Aid lived in. And the love shack, I'm glad it can't talk.
I hear all these great things about Adrian Ledger. He must have gone out like a young lad at some stage.
Yeah, he was always pretty cheeky. Trav probably spent more time with him at the pub than us too, but once we got to 18 and we hit the pubs, there was always a bit of mischief going on, put it that way. But he was a pretty cheeky sort of fella too, but he just loved life. Like any jockeys, he got angry pretty quickly, like most of them do. So if anyone sort of said anything negative towards him or the stables or anything like that, he fired up pretty quickly. But you look on the good side of people. But yeah, he could turn like any of us can sometimes. And also remember one day there he had a fall and he just bruised his ribs or whatnot, so he had to stand down for a couple of weeks. And we had a horse running at Bendigo, a horse called Special Deal, and we're sitting inside there watching it on TVN, and the horse got beaten a short half head. And anyway, me and Brad are throwing the control and carrying on. He goes, "Geez, you just carry on." And we said, "Yeah, well, that's what we do when you ride and you get beaten." So from then on, he realised the emotion from you know, the family side and what it meant to win a race and whatnot. And I think he put that into every ride, sort of from that time on. Once you've seen it from the inside, what the emotion people have watching their own horses and the training that goes into them. I think from that day on, when he rode, he just rode with a little bit more vigour and just wanted to do the right thing for everybody.
These kids were riding horses that you wouldn't wish to ride, but they had to make a living. They were married or getting married. They had young families on the way, and you know, it was $80 or $100 a seat, and they needed that money, and they would do whatever they could to survive and look after their families. And they rode horses that, you know, you probably didn't want to get on sometimes, but, you know, the phone rang and you could make the weight, you had to ride it. You know, I was more worried about him driving than I was him race riding. And we used to have rules, you know, I'd ring every 2 hours and make him pull over on the side of the road and take a power nap and all those things. And what do parents do? And you tried so hard to protect them, but at the end of the day, you can't wrap them in cotton wool.
Coming up, coping with tragedy and the invaluable support provided by the racing family. The Memorial to Fallen Jockeys at Caulfield Racecourse commemorates the lives of 312 riders killed. Since it was built, the names of a further 194 who died in racing-related incidents have been discovered. All 506 are now remembered on September 1, National Jockey Celebration Day. The racing industry is determined to ensure they are never forgotten.
In my rearview, I watch you, and I gave you your life, but you give me mine. I see you slowly swim away, as the light is leaving town, to a place that I can't be. There's no apologies, just go on, just go on. There's still so many things I wanna say to you, but go on, just go on. We're bound by blood that's moving from the moment that we start, from the moment that we start.
The memorial here was established or created and unveiled in 2005. Ned Wallace was the driving force behind it, who was a great historian and a great champion for jockeys' causes. But it celebrates the lives and the contribution of some 312 riders at this stage. But just recently, we knew we'd miss some on the way through, and there are another 194 been identified since the initial memorial was created. So it's quite extraordinary. And for every one of those riders who've given their life for the industry, there are obviously dozens, if not hundreds and thousands, who've suffered severe injuries as well.
These two great young Victorians, Mark Goring and Adrian Ledger, and great families of racing behind them.
They have, Bruce. They did have, and it's great that their families are happy to remember them and have it out there that just the contribution that Mark and Adrian both made, and of course Gavin Lisk at the same time as Adrian, and Andrew Gilbert just before those boys as well. But it's a special memorial. Anyone who's at Caulfield Racecourse should have a look at it near the racecourse office here. And it's a special, special memorial.
The racing industry were and have been fantastic. They have been there for me 100%. Des O'Keefe, he has got me through a lot. Lisa Stevens, I don't know where I'd be without her. Mark's friends, who are jockeys. Strangers, I've had strangers help me. Obviously my family and my friends. My support group has been fantastic and I couldn't ask anything more from the racing industry.
We're very lucky to have the racing industry to support you, because I know there's a lot of families out there that lose their sons and husbands and that, and they don't have the support that the racing industry has given us and Emma and the kids. And it's just fantastic to have that. Yeah.
I remember when Adrian and I went to Mark's funeral in Cranbourne, and we went down and I'd said, Adrian and I, we just couldn't believe what had happened, and we felt we were just so sad then at that stage, and who was to know what was to happen. I've got three sisters. My mum and dad were fantastic. Had support from the Ledger family. We're very close and they're still great support to me today. They're great support to Josh and I, and even little Nicholas, my other son. And also the support through Racing Victoria, it's just incredible. Had Lisa Stevens, counsellor, help us all through a really tricky time.
Des O'Keefe and his crew, we're so lucky in this country to have somebody looking after the jockeys like that person. He is a superman, and he's after care for Adrian and Adrian's family and Lisa Stevens and Adrian's brothers right to this day, because we still get affected with a phone call or a call in just to make sure everybody's ticking along okay. Is unbelievable.
It's critical that they know that their sons aren't forgotten, and husbands and fathers aren't forgotten. It's a privileged position that I'm in. It can be a difficult position at times. What interests me though, Bruce, is that the jockeys who are riding, it's never discussed, it's never mentioned. Every one of them's aware of it. I don't know many that actually come and look at the memorial. It's probably way too close to home, but it's quite often to come here. There are flowers in the little holders there beside each of the 312 names on this memorial, and as I say, it's a privileged position that I'm in, and it's an honour to be involved.
Des must have put a memo out to the jocks that make sure you all got some insurance and make sure you're happy with your insurance, and Aid must have got hold of that memo somehow and doubled his ante, you know, and when he went down, that ante was enough to buy Joshua and Amy a beautiful home and quite a few acres of land and a motor car. And that was one worry that Amy didn't have to have. And there again, you know, just always thinking ahead of the square, and thought things can happen to you. And just like the organ donor, he's helped other people, and he never left his own wife and child in dire straits. And so that's been a wonderful contribution to Maid as well.
Seeing Emma, not often, but several times a year, seeing Maddie and Mitch growing up, I can imagine just how proud Mark would be. I can imagine how proud he is of how his mother, Gail, has dealt with everything, and the family have dealt with everything. And I think he'd also be proud and appreciative of how the industry's supported Emma and the children. And those two kids that we've seen are just two of the most beautiful kids you'd see. The same with the Ledger family, who are obviously heavily still involved in the industry, and also Amy as well, and her son. I think the whole thing's just, it's great that they would really appreciate the support the industry's given them.
It was a big night at Caulfield to support you and the future and the kids, and a great celebration of Mark.
That night I will never ever forget. A lot back then is a blur, but what they did was unbelievable. Without their help, these children wouldn't be at the school they are at today. They the organisation for the benefit night, they did it so quick. I think it was only a fortnight after Mark had passed away, and it was a huge success.
Coming up, looking to the future for two families for whom racing still means so much. Mark Goring and Adrian Ledger both fathered sons they were never to see. Mark's daughter Madeline was just 2.5 when she lost her dad. Mitchell Goring loves horses and is showing promise as a rider, which presents an obvious dilemma.
I'm very proud of these children. They've been through a lot. And, you know, it's been very tough, very, very tough. But I have had a lot of support and a lot of help, and I think that's how they are such good kids today.
What a very handsome bunch of kids. Madeline, what's he like? What's Mitch like as a brother?
Oh, he's okay. He sometimes gets annoying, but I suppose he's all right.
How does he get annoying?
Just being a little brother, I suppose.
You've got to look after him, though, don't you?
Yeah, I try to, but he always sort of wants to go his own way. And
oh, that's not right, is it? No, of course not. Now, you look at that face, you couldn't be naughty, could you?
Yes.
Maddie's the hard one, but she's growing into a beautiful young woman. He would be so proud of her. She's not really into the horses. She's actually allergic to them like I am. So that was a nightmare when Mark would come home with his race gear. He would have to take it straight to the laundry and do it all himself, and, you know, I'd have the itchy eyes straight away. Maddie would have the itchy eyes straight away. Maddie wants to be a neurosurgeon.
Well, I'm for the top. Yeah, you talk about Mitch being the image of his dad, and loving the horses, and he's actually been on the back of a couple of race horses already, so
yes.
Obviously he's got the bug.
Absolutely loves it.
Has Mum got the bug?
No. We just keep feeding him.
I know where your thinking comes from, but he's a young boy, mm-hmm. Going to a man who wants to do something. What would you say?
At times I feel very selfish saying it, that I don't want him to become a jockey. But as Gail said, it's in his blood. He loves it. You really can't stop him. I often think of Damien Oliver's mum. I don't want to be in the same situation as her, losing her husband and her son. But at the end of the day, I suppose if he really wants to do that, I have to let him. He is like a mini Mark. I have days where it hurts, but I have other days where I wouldn't want it any other way. And I often think, if I feel like that, imagine how that must make Mark's mum feel. She knew Mark at that age. I obviously didn't. And it would be like her looking at Mark when, you know, things he does. Just his personality, everything. He's just him all over.
We look at the kids today and you know, you must be thrilled at how they've turned out.
Oh, look, he'd be so proud of them. They're gorgeous kids, the pair of them. You know, and Mitchell, you get a bit, not sad, but just, I suppose, melancholy, because Mitchell's just the image of Mark, and it's like watching Mark growing up all over again, you know. So I suppose in that way it's really good that we've got them, you know, whereas Andrew Gilbert had no one to continue on from him. Hmm. Whereas with Adrian Ledger and Mark, we've got their children, you know, we've got a legacy. Hmm. So, you know, that's great. We've got a part of him still here.
Do you have much link to racing today?
I sort of have no choice with Mitchell around. He puts the races on a fair bit. If my friend's horse is running, or if my parents' horse is racing, I will watch it. It doesn't hurt me watching it anymore. It took me a very long time to get over that. But I'm fine with it now.
We go to Chitura every year, and there's sort of like a little ceremony there for him. Mm. So, yeah.
Must be tough doing that, though.
Yeah, it's sort of scary, but sort of fun at the same time.
It's also
time.
Great that your dad's remembered by
yeah.
So many people.
Yeah, it is good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's it like with Mum?
Yeah,
she's had a tough go, hasn't she?
Yeah, very. It's been hard some years, but some years is better than others, and some days, and it all changes, really.
You find it tough, Mitch, at times?
Yeah.
Must be hard, because you never got to meet your dad.
Yeah.
But you see so many things of him and be proud of what he did. And you want to do the same thing. Ride with us.
Yep.
Do you see much of Adrian in Josh?
Yeah, a few people ask me that, and I just see Josh, to be honest. I just see Josh as his own person. I can see small resemblances in appearance and looks, but I mostly see Josh. He's a gorgeous boy, and I think it's hard to say that a child resembles someone that you knew as an adult. I sort of don't see really any similarities at this stage, but I hope that Josh grows and develops to be a really beautiful person like his dad was, and he has all of those amazing qualities that his dad had.
He calls himself Boomer Harvey when he's got his North Melbourne footy jumper on, and I tackled him the other day, and I played with Aid for many, many hours over the years, and the most uncanny look of Adrian the other day just was almost frightening, and brought a tear to my eye, Bruce, to see his dad laying on the ground playing ball with me. I'd never seen it before, and it was wonderful just to catch a glimpse of that. So it was something special. It's not there all the time, but it was there the other day. I just seen Aid's face, and it was great.
You've got a great place for him to grow up on here, and there's memories of Adrian about?
Yeah, there's memories. I had a beautiful horse that Adrian rode and was sort of owned by his dad, called FedEx. And after Adrian died and the horse retired, I was lucky enough to take on this thoroughbred and train it for an event horse. And unfortunately, a few years ago, it broke its neck in the paddock in a freak accident. So the horse is buried here in the backyard. And Craig, my partner, came home one day with two beautiful Canadian maples, and we planted them. We planted one for Adrian and one for the horse, and they're just, yeah, really taking off out in the yard.
The trees are doing magnificently well. Obviously got some good help down there.
Yeah, they have.
Why, that's there, and photo up here of him winning at Caulfield on Brave Chief, and Josh and Amy and the barn, and what's in our hearts, he'll never leave us. And it was a really lovely gesture every year by the Aubrey Racing Club on their Aubrey Cup Day, where they have the Adrian Legend Memorial. And we've been lucky enough to win it twice. We won the first one, which was absolutely magic, and we won another one since, which is also very nice. And good trainers like Bede Murray and those guys have come down and won it, and makes us proud that they want to win Age Race. But at the same time, when the guy from Country Racing Victoria, who sponsored the race, said this year that they will continue to sponsor the memorial race, not only for Adrian, but for all riders throughout Australia who fall or are seriously injured and have impaired their normal life. Adrian's memorial race is to let them know that the racing fraternity thinks of everybody who's been injured or fatally killed in a race mishap or a training mishap, that the industry hasn't forgotten them, and we're not likely to forget them. So it's not only Adrian Ledger Memorial, it's a jockeys and track workers memorial as well.
G'day Joshua, it's Damien Oliver here, mate. I had the pleasure of riding with your father Adrian, and he was a very good jockey and an even better horseman. And what's even more important, he was a terrific bloke, and he's sadly missed by all of us. And sort of know what you're going through, mate. I lost my father at a pretty young age as well. But you got to be strong, mate, and give your mother the best support you can throughout your life. And, you know, if you're anything like your old man, mate, you'll grow up to be a terrific bloke. All the best, mate.
Rob set up a DVD a few months after the accident where his crew at Racing Victoria felt that they should do something for Joshua and Amy, for Amy to explain to Josh as he grows up what his dad did and what sort of bloke his dad was. And it's a magnificent DVD that we turn to every now and then when you feel a little bit low or you'd like to have a word with Age. You come in here and you turn on the DVD and cry your eyes out and love every minute of it.
I know that Adrian's brothers, Chris and Brad and Travis, they love you to death and they'll support you forever, so hope you're a good boy and be well.
Lady Glover trying very hard on the outside. He's coming out after Master Tyanga. Master Tyanga, no good thing. Romantic Lover picked him up to the line, and Romantic Lover's coming away. Romantic Lover wins a length and a quarter, Master Tyanga.
Adrian was everything to all of us. He was a very special guy. There was, you know, 2,500-3,000 people at his funeral, Bruce, and that speaks volume for a young bloke. They have a golf day for him. They name races after him. People talk about him regularly. It's quite ironic. He was great mates with Mark Goring. Mm. He was shattered when Mark got killed. Mark, when he rode up this way, used to stay with us. I can remember one day Kerry and I going down and picking them both up at Hobson's Lodge where they were doing work experience for Gerald Ryan, and took them for lunch, and two little snowy-haired kids running around Melbourne with us for the day, and I'll never forget it because here we are all these years later and we've lost them both. So it's pretty tough going, but the boys, they really loved Aid. They did look up to him, they idolised him, they worked today in his honour. And we're proud of that. We're proud of the way Adrian influenced a lot of lives, and we're proud of the friendship that we made in the racing industry through Adrian.
We've always made it part of the deal that we'd talk about Aid as if he was still here or refer to him. It's never been, oh, don't mention it. And I think that way we've kept his memory alive. Give ourselves a bit of an outlet as well, instead of bottling things up. We often talk about him several times a week. His name would be mentioned just in conversation around here. And to be quite a few years now after the fact, it's still a great aspect of it, I think, that we can talk about him and enjoy Amy and enjoy Josh.
Initially, I had no interest whatsoever to be back at the race course or watch races or show any interest until Craig and I got together, my new partner, and he was Adrian's good friend. So it's funny how things work out, really, that Craig's been in the industry his whole life, and he's just gotten his trainer's licence, and he's got a really good opportunity to train now. He's doing a great job, and I've been able to, I think you just do it as you feel you can, and I've found that I've been able to go and give him a hand and go to the jump outs with him or whatever, and found myself back at the races. Yeah, certainly a little bit of hesitation there, but it's just getting back. Yeah, I'm slowly finding an interest again.
Every year I go to the Racing Awards, the Scobie. I go to a fair few functions with Des O'Keefe. And by doing that, I don't feel Mark will ever be forgotten.
Since Mark and Adrian and Andrew Gilbert and Gavin Lisk, we've had the Jockeys Memorial Day at the races. They've got that new statue at Caulfield now where all the names of all the jockeys and everything are. We go to Tatura every year for a memorial race for Mark, and he's got a plaque up there with the, you know, in the little garden under near the winning post there. And Adrian's got the same, and so is Andrew at Benalla. So, you know, they'll never be forgotten. Racing keeps them alive.